Juan. It's no surprise, because this is a really great historic event that we are doing tonight. I'm thrilled you could join us today for our Miami Generation Revisited panel discussion. And I'm very pleased to have the artists with us today, and they'll be introduced after. But it takes a lot to do these exhibitions and programs. And I would like to introduce one of our sponsors, is Wells Fargo, which has made it possible for us to bring 1,000 children from low-income families to the museum this summer to see the exhibition and do a hands-on project connected with the exhibition. This is extraordinary to think that all these children will get to experience this work and understand the experience that these artists have gone through as the part of the first generation of Cuban exiles in Miami. I'd like to now introduce not only the sponsor, but one of our great members of the Board of Governors of the Museum of Art, Walker Duval.
One other thing, there's a major soccer game going on also. I think it's especially terrific. Well, good afternoon, good evening. It's my pleasure to represent Wells Fargo as a corporate sponsor of this historically significant exhibition. Wells Fargo, as Bonnie mentioned, is a longtime supporter of the NS Museum of Art. For this exhibition, Wells Fargo awarded a $15,000 grant to provide transportation to over 1,000 loads of moderate-income summer campers from the Tri-County area to see this historic exhibition, experience a hands-on studio art class, and be inspired to explore the many art forms that are critical to diverse industries, from architecture to web design, photography to engineering, and beyond. Wells Fargo's commitment to the communities we serve is central to our vision and values. We strongly believe Wells Fargo can only be successful if those we serve are also successful. This is why in 2013, Wells Fargo invested more than $3.2 million in support of non-profit organizations and schools across South Florida. Wells Fargo Associates look forward to continuing to support the outstanding exhibitions of the NSU Museum of Art, Fort Lauderdale, that enrich our community and help it make an exceptional place to live, work, and visit. Enjoy the exhibition.
Thank you, Walker. Really, this has made it a special event for us. Now it gives me great pleasure to introduce a very dear colleague of mine who has been instrumental in guiding this museum and had the foresight to make one of the focuses of the museum its collection and exhibition program, Latin American art, but particularly the Cuban American experience. Jorge Santi has been with the museum since 1977. This is extraordinary. And he has curated this wonderful exhibition, Miami Generation Revisited. And it's bittersweet, because after all these years, he is now, after this exhibition, it will be retiring from the museum. But actually, even though he retired June 30th, he's been at the museum every day. And I suspect he will be here every day from now on, because he is so much a part of this museum. Jorge Santos, please come up and join us.
Say my people. So welcome all of you to the Museum of Art. I am not going to be long. I know that we're here basically to listen to our wonderful panelists, including Helen Kohen, which is an honor for me to have Helen Kohen. I am at the Oscars now. John Donne, the poet, said over 3 centuries ago, no man is an island. And I think that when it comes to the work that I have done here at the museum, those words really apply. I have 7 people that I'm going to name. Of course, I'm going to make a few enemies along the way. But there are 7 people who make my life easier. Why? Because they gave me trust, encouragement, and support when I needed it the most. Some of them are dead. The first 4 are dead, and the last 3, thanks to the Lord, are still alive. They are Virginia Alexander, Betty Curry, Ira Watkins, Richard Hilker, Carol Damien. Kenworth Moffitt, and Jose Martinez Cano. These people stood by me from day one, and I really could not have done it without them. So please, I would like a round of applause for those. Thank you very much. Enjoy the show, and always keep in mind that I know that the curator gets all the credit, but that is not so. When it comes to this show, from Ms. Clearwater, our new director and chief curator, to the registrar, Antonia, everyone worked very hard. Thank you.
Thank you, Jorge. And as I said, we know that you're not going to be leaving us. You'll be here every day at the museum, where we're happy to have you. Before I introduce our moderators, Helen Cohen and our respondent, Dr. Juan Martinez, let me give you a little bit of background on this exhibition. In 1983, Miami's former Cuban Museum of Art and Culture presented the groundbreaking exhibition, The Miami Generation, which represented a pivotal moment in South Florida's cultural history and brought together, for the first time, 9 emerging artists from Miami's Cuban exile community who were part of the first generation that received its artistic education in the United States. Now, more than 30 years later, NSU Museum of Art picks up where this exhibition left off, with the Miami Generation revisited. Now, I had one reporter ask me, well, is this show about how the artist's work has changed over the 30 years? And yes, in a way it is. And 30 years is a long time for an artist to keep working and work evolve. But also I was thinking how much it's also about how these artists and this generation has changed the cultural life of South Florida. These artists particularly, and their generation, were among the first artists to decide to stay in Miami and make it their home base for an international career. In a large way, we have them to credit for the amazing artistic renaissance that we've been experiencing in South Florida for the last 30 years. Around them, a group of artists, group collectors, dealers, critics, everything that we know makes an art scene. So it's really important for us to realize how groundbreaking this was. I'm also pleased to point out that this museum has made it a focus to collect work from this generation, as well as other Cuban American and Cuban diaspora artists. And also, we are launching this spring our Stanley and Pearl Goodman Research Center in Latin American Art. And that will be launched along with an exhibition of Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera from the Jacques and Natasha Gellman collection, and Mexican 20th century art from the Pearl and Stanley Goodman collection. So as you can see, that this is an ongoing commitment from the museum for this work. I would like to following sponsors. Without their generosity, so generous support, this exhibition would not be possible. Firstly, exhibitions at NSU Museum of Art are made possible in part by a challenge grant from David and Francie Horvitz Family Foundation. I would also like to thank our lead sponsor, the Hudson Family Foundation, Holly and Scott Oldenweber, whatever. And Holly is also a dedicated member of the Museum Board of Governors. And of course, we've heard from Wells Fargo, and thank you, Morgan DeVal, again. The McDaniel, Siegel, and Johnson families, in memory of Anna T. McDaniel, who was one of the founders of this great institution, again, has made this possible, greatly due because of their love for Jorge. Bacardi and Premier Beverage has provided our specialty drinks this evening, so drink up. Or Reinhardt, but maybe we should have coffee before you leave. Or Reinhardt, Bacardi's Vice President of Corporate Communications, I thank you as well. Our media partner, Selecta Magazine, Jenny Starr Perez, and Event Chief, Selecta Magazine. I'd like to thank my extraordinary staff for dedicating themselves to this exhibition and making sure that it looks as spectacular as it does. Especially to thank our senior curator, Dr. Barbara Lyons, our exhibition designer, Luke Jenkins, and the entire staff of registrars, including our assistant registrar, Ventoya, for doing such a great job getting all the works here and cataloged. Sonia Seisaltz, who and Carmen Maria Aguirre were instrumental in getting the word out, and I think they did a fabulous job. Tonight, and Miami itself is empty. So it also gives me great pleasure to thank the museum's board of governors and all the members that are here tonight, as well as NSU for their tremendous support. And now I'd like to introduce our moderator for tonight, as well as our moderator respondent, Helen Cohen, a longtime friend. And is an art historian and critic who has authored numerous articles on contemporary art focusing on the formation of the culture, art culture in Miami since the early 1970s. Helen Cohen is art critic emerita for the Miami Herald newspaper, one of the founders of the Pasari Project Archive for Miami-Dade Public Library System, of which we have benefited from in this exhibition, as we have a number of amazing documents from that exhibition, from the original exhibition. And also moderating as respondent is Dr. Martinez, who is Professor Emeritus in the Department of Art and Art History at Florida International University in Miami, who taught courses in European and Cuban modern art. He is the author of Cuban Art and National Identity, The Vanguardia Painters, 1927 to 1950. And Carlos Enriquez, the painter of Cuban ballads. And another book, Maria Brito, one of our artists today. Before we start, there's one more person I would like to acknowledge because it was really her thinking many years ago that made this the original show possible. And I would like to thank and us all welcome Margarita Cano.
Notable artists here. one of whom doubles as an arts activist and writer. Plus we have Juan Martinez, our panel respondent tonight, who wears about 8 hats, mostly as a celebrated author and teacher. And also tonight we have the kind of spirits of people who are not here, but they're always present because their works are in the gallery. The 3 artists who are no longer living. And the original curator of the original show, who's also no longer living. So they're here tonight, and I wonder, ask any of you who have any recollections in your own answer, as you answer the questions, if you can remember something about them, just bring them in, because they're here. So, and I am planning to be a very fierce moderator. So you're going to have a mere 5 minutes to speak, and that means 4 minutes. So, and if you're not done, you're finished. So, I just want to lay out what I'm thinking of. I got my questions basically from thinking about this for a long time, knowing what Juan was interested in, what César was interested in, and what I was interested in. This is one of many events, by the way, accompanying the and illuminating this exhibition, so I think you all have to come back several times before this is over. It is the 30th anniversary, and the works that are in the show by the 9 original artists had this in common. They were all born in Cuba, and they became professional artists in Miami. Now, back then, they were not referred to as emerging artists. They mostly were, and are sometimes still known, as Cuban-American artists, with hyphens. It was and remains a label that represents absolutely nothing about their art. As a group, they were an ungroup, a non-group. They represented no particular school, and no ism that we recognize. Today, artists native to other countries who come to work here have better labels. We call them international. We call them global. In the early 80s, we called our hyphenated artists exiles, a somewhat lesser term, advancing a more desperate sounding condition. One main impetus of this exhibition back then was to expose the strength and the staying power of those 9 artists, to literally show them off, lift them up, and send them out. But those times were not these times. The whole temper of Miami's art scene was very different then. Smaller, mostly unsung, and certainly more modest. We were not yet the center of the universe, where all the worldly art heavies came to visit in December. To appreciate the landmark status of this show in its original form, we constantly need to be reminded of that and to know how much attitudes about art, that's with a small a and with a big a, how they have changed in 30 years. So in addition to discussing, all of you get your pencils out, in addition to discussing the issue of labeling, we hope to talk a little about the content of the art, the role of nostalgia, if there was one, or politics, or nothing. And what about geography? What was the influence of Miami, of South Florida, on the artists, then and now? And for those who left, why? And if you came back, why? So I'll make a more formal questionnaire here. Number one. What did that hyphen in Cuban American mean to you? Were you truly bicultural in your thinking, or did you find it a divisive signifier, separating you from both the Cuban and the American cultural traditions, as well as both communities of artists? And what about now? Do the old labels fit any artists, art forms? And what happened in the meantime? And how did, that's one. Number two, sure. So that's labeling. Okay. Number two, don't forget you only have 4 minutes, so get your minds going. How did the bicultural factor figure in the artwork itself? Were there visual clues or omens pointing to political content, or to put it simply, would the viewer know from a work of art that you, the artist, was participating in a balancing act, juggling issues, cultures, backgrounds, your future, your past? And number three, what about the role of Miami, its environment, its citizens, its attitudes in the development of your art? Was it the pull that kept you here, or the one that brought you back when and if you left? You're done. Mario, we're doing this alphabetically. We hope that they really keep you 4 minutes and that you get a chance to ask. If not afterwards, when they're drinking, ask.
Okay, I'm going to turn my answer into a question.
Okay.
Do we have any Irish Americans here, or Jewish Americans here, or Italian Americans here, or Greek Americans here, or Portuguese?
Or women artists. How about women artists?
Or women artists. Well, I think that when I first came to New York, I was 14 years old, and we came from Madrid. And I realized that this was home. Everybody was different. Everybody looked different. Unlike Madrid, everybody was homogeneous. And I just thought, this is the perfect place for me to be the other here. And I became an American as soon as I stepped in New York City. And people would say, well, he's Irish American, he's Jewish American from Brooklyn. So I started to identify the differences. And so I think that we're all Americans. But those labels are never lost, because the biggest parade in this country is St. Patrick's Parade. Right? And it's everybody's Irish, especially the Irish. So you and Americans are no different. It's just where we were born and where we came, or we chose, or we were sent. So, being born in Cuba is oftentimes a responsibility in a way, because everybody has an opinion on it. I like it, I don't like it, he's good, they're bad, I'm talking to the government, whatever. But for us, growing up here, because I started eighth grade, it was very clear to me that I would eventually go back to my birth country as I did in 1996, to put that behind. So in a previous question that I received in email, how are you different, Cuban American, and the show was in 1983, so this is the 31st anniversary, not the 30th.
We're slow.
My time's up.
But your time is running.
Yeah. So I don't know. It's organic to me. I don't think I'm more Cuban than American. I'm more American than Cuban.
What about your art?
My art is very much influenced by European art, which, by the way, influenced American modern art. Rothko was from Latvia, Gorky was from Armenia, De Kooning was from the Netherlands. For me, I never saw a painting in Cuba. I never went to a museum there. It was a country boy. I didn't know what a museum looked like. There's a Pinareña over there. And two, actually. And so the first painting I saw was in Madrid, and it was like, wow. But it wasn't until I got to New York, and somehow I made my way. I was in a foster museum. And I went into the Modern Art Museum of Modern Art, and then I saw a Rothko painting. And now that changed my life. It's like that. And he was an immigrant too, and there would not be contemporary American art without him.
But in a sense, all Americans are immigrants.
Exactly. I can aid it as well.
Sis. Okay, you have used up your 4 minutes. Thank you. Maria?
All right. Helen, I wrote my
Go ahead. Answer. Go ahead.
Because I, unlike my friend here, I cannot just.
Do you need a mic?
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
All right. So, as an answer to your questions that you sent us via email, First, I want to say that I intend my remarks here as part of a conversation, not as a line of argument. Most of what I say is rooted in my experience, so no doubt, as our experiences differ, all of us, so will our responses to the question from California. My first thought when I read your questions is that in 1984, when the Miami Generation Exhibition first opened, we were only 2.5 decades into the exile experience. A large part of the exile community has now lived in South Florida for over 5 decades. In 1984, our parents, and perhaps many of us, were concerned that we might lose our unique Cuban identity in predominantly non-Hispanic South Florida. Now, in 1984, back then, in 1984, I had already completed both a Master of Science in Education and a Master of Fine Arts. I was married to my second husband and raising 4 boys. I worked my
And your nails were always painted, I remember.
Billberg changed my mind on that. Good old Billberg. I worked maniacally in my home studio while the boys were in school. I mention all of these personal details because they explain why I had no time to reflect on my place in the universe, and more specifically, my place in society. In essence, I lived in a capsule bound by motherhood, family, marriage, and my studio work. Needless to say, in order to carry out all of my responsibilities, I had to live a very disciplined life every single day. Briefly then, in the 1980s, the term Cuban American meant to me, in answer to your question, meant to me protection and powerful family ties and rituals. Today, 30 years later, I look at the term Cuban American as most of us must, from a different perspective. Today, I worry about other things. I worry about being defined by what critics and writers assume I am as a Cuban American artist when the term Cuban American becomes the lens through which my work is perceived. I resist and I push back. In too many reviews, for instance, the fact that I arrived in this country as a federal time child is used to interpret my work. Was that experience formative and important to me? Absolutely. But was it definitive, and did it ever find its way into my work? Absolutely not.
You have about 30 seconds.
Okay, I have the last page. From the onset of my career as an artist, my work has dealt with essential and universal existence as defined by emotions, sensations, personal memory, psychological situations, knowledge, and perception. The imagery that I use is symbolic of the process of self-discovery, and it is a personal iconographic system developed from my identity as a woman, a mother, an exiled Cuban, a naturalized American, and a Catholic. Now, alongside the particular details of my existence, my work is an exploration of the intrinsically universal elements that each aspect of my being represents. These being gender, family, national and ethnic identity, religion, and beyond religion, the unexplained realities that lie beyond life and the certainty of death.
You're done.
No, one more thing.
I give you a minute.
Okay. I just wanted to say
See how
gracious you are.
Recent works also explore the dark side of human nature and to what Todd Behrens of the Folk Museum of Art refers to as the quote, the idea that humankind itself has built into the structures of our societies and cultures the means of its own demise, as is, I guess, the piece as of 2403-07, which is in the exhibition, exemplifies. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
We're all along from 1960 to that period, we're called human exiles. And the term started, I think, you know, after that, when a lot of people started becoming citizens and voting and all that. So at that point, I don't think that term meant anything to me.
But remember, you were the oldest.
Yeah, exactly. That's,
you were
that's
the oldest.
I was thinking of that when Mary was talking about his experience. Mine, I came when I was already 16.
Yeah.
And I was 100% human already. And my first 30 or 40 years have been like a fight to remain human. You know, I don't want him to lose that identity.
But who are you battling now?
Yeah?
Who are you battling now?
No, I'm not battling anybody. And now, going back to human in 2008, I realized how American I am. You know, it's a process. It's a process that starts, you know, taking place inside you when you don't analyze it. But all of a sudden, you realize, you know, I no longer belong in my original place, I belong somewhere else. But it's a painful process, because you see it, your culture and your nature sort of disappear from the map. And then the term, we love the term human American, well, we travel, because we want to make sure we're not confused by being a comic from Cuba. You said, we're Cubans from Miami, we're Cuban American. So we specify it very clearly. But now, as far as my work, I guess I can say it's human. I try to make it more universal because I deal with feelings of, say, separation, alienation, some nostalgia, but those are universal feelings. The imagery I use is more human because I guess it's what's in my mind. And also, like you said, you know, I was too old already when I came to change my language of communication. My visual language, but do I have time left?
Yes, you do.
Oh, even
yes.
If I gave my
you
did,
yes, you still have almost a minute.
No, I guess it's a very complicated. I gave a little conference in FIU one time at the School of Exile. They have like a department now for exile studies, and I was I analyzed myself that day, and I was putting an example that remembering. Jewish people in Cuba and Arab people in Cuba, they always try to marry within their group, and we didn't understand that. Then we Cubans started doing the same thing here. And it's just, you're trying to protect your
But I have a son-in-law named Martinez.
Huh?
I have a son-in-law named Martinez.
Oh, yeah, well, actually, we're in Cuba, we didn't mind our, you know, family marrying foreigners. But then once you're threatened as a group, you're trying to, you know, stake your own. And that is the reason. But for example, my wife came when she was 10. She was assimilated perfectly. You know, and she didn't even have an accent in English. And her days are much more American. So I guess there's an early adolescence is where your roots sort of, you know, form and define more of what you are. Then it takes years of adjustment to change that and become more and more of your new environment.
Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much.
Testing, testing. Testing, testing.
No waste of the seconds.
Cuban American. What is that? I read the catalog and I think reread it, and I think that Julio said it best. We're Cuban, we're American, and something more. And that something more is, to me, very poetic, because it means anything. It's use your imagination. Politics, bicultural factors, all of those things entered into my work. You have to remember, I was very young.
You were the youngest. He was the youngest.
I was 22. I was very impressionable. I have to mention that César Trasobares' work, Fernando García's work, Maria Brito's work, were incredibly influential in my work growing up and looking at what they were doing and looking at the studios. All of that influenced me. Those early refrigerators, all that came from the environments that Maria Brito was doing. The quinceañera that César brought to a gallery opening one day because one of his works was not accepted. That, to me, was pivotal. I just thought that was art, you know, that was different and theatrical. And the role of Miami in my work was also very pivotal. An epiphany moment there came when Bonnie Clearwater asked me to come and do my marionette shows for the MoCA. And that call, I'll never forget. It was in 1998, and by 1999, I worked with Herman Romney on a production called Once Upon an Island. And this was a love story between Prince Miami and Princess Havana, and all the trouble they get into. So it was really an amazing experience working 16 years with the Museum of Contemporary Art, and all these shows that were produced, and you can see them, some parts of them in the exhibit. And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about Sebastiana as well, because that was a very early work. It was a mural that I painted in Paris, and it was a very visceral, meaningful, personal painting about the Cuban exile experience. You see La Sebastiana alive, very much alive, but in her oppressive ropes, and arrows piercing her here and there, full of torture and pain. And the horse becomes, for me, symbolically America, unable to help, unable to undo the ties that bind her. And at the end is Santa Teresa, which is the Cuban community, in Miami, the exile community, waiting for something to happen. And that was one of my first experiences with painting. And now I'm looking again at painting very differently than I did in 1983. And it's, to me, very, very challenging. And I'm re-looking at Emilio's work. I'm re-looking at Humberto Calzada's work and his work, because I want to paint. I want to, now in my life, I want to paint again, 53. And I'm seeing what I didn't see in 1983. And
that's all. It's beautiful.
Yes, my experience was kind of, you know, very revealing. I came into like Pedro Pan, you know, the boys I came from Cuba with our parents. And the first Christmases I passed for 3 or 4 years, we were invited to a Jewish home. I think it was in Miami Beach. I remember it was a beautiful garden, and they celebrated for us Christmas party. And the one that was invited with us was Father Brian O. Walsh, And he was an Irish that loved us as a father. And his Jewish friend was for us also like a relative. So that gave me an idea right off that somehow I was going into not a melting pot, because I don't like the melting pot, but more like a community, a community. And when I was thinking about what I have done and things, what I see mainly is relationships. I'm not so much introspective into my own, looking into my own, but rather connecting things. We are all connected, you know, in all cultures, in all history of art. There is a connection. There is also differences. There is schools, and very different. But at the same time, there is something common. There is something in man that is always the same. And is also understandable. It doesn't matter if it's a man from the Cape, you know, Pasco, or Altamira, or if it's a man from the 21st century. You know, we have something in common. And we can relate to that art of other peoples, other cultures, other, you know. And also, that happened in the community, the little community that we have. We were related also. We mentioned Helen Cohen, we mentioned Margarita Cano. I used to spend hours in the public library. Margarita was so nice to bring all types of photographs that she had in archives of different things. So I was looking at paintings that I could not travel to see in the museum. I looked at them in the public library and I studied them there. Also, the first group that we had, mainly, basically, wasn't possible without the idea and the input of Miguel Jorge, Ricky Jorge, which was an artist, and he saw in us somehow some kind of a spark of the future, something, I don't know. But he gathered us and said, we have to do something with these young kids, you know, and exhibit their works, do something. And he started doing something before the Miami generation. So somehow, also, I went to the Miami Lake Junior College, at that time it was Junior College, and but I spent some time, you know, in the University of Miami. Also, I had some friends there. And I became a very good friend of Juan Gonzalez, of Natalio Chedia, etc. You know, so we used to gather at night, you know, there was a place that we gathered, you know, to talk about, you know, art and movies and things like some type of tertulia or something like that, you know. And also, we had a lot of relationships between us, our own. We visited each other a lot. We knew what we were doing. We were able to communicate a lot. And we loved each other, I think. We had a very close relationship. We went to Maria's house, invited everybody. And somehow, we were like a small family.
It sounds like we're going off to Bermuda, and he didn't.
I don't know about my time.
Yeah, no, but that's very, again, yeah. That's very, very sweet, and I think it gives everybody a real feeling about what this disparate group we look like. We don't know each other, but or we are know each other. César, you have the last word here.
I'm going to borrow Helen's microphone. Upon Emilio's last point, that we were connected in different ways. We had gone to school together. At some point or another, we were all student assistants. We had shared some of the teachers. So oftentimes, even though our discourse was a discourse of ideas, we did not think about our ideas being particularly Cuban. Our ideas were burning issues that we were exploring in our own lives as we went through the years and the various technological generations. I don't know how many of you recall the purple fingers from the mimeograph machine, and the first time the fax machine became a reality, and then the Xerox machine, and on through to today's computers and emails. Despite all of this, the way that other people see us is now very much conditioned by the whole multicultural revolution. We were multicultural before there was such a thing. Today's atmosphere of political correctness has led to a lot of rethinking about who we are as individuals, as artists, as contributing members of an intellectual community. And I, in my own work, I try to deal a little bit with this, the various definitions of the degrees of Cubanness. I remember Cubanazo, Cubano Arrepentido, Super Cuban, Cuban American Princess, and more recently the Cuban Moguls. None of us are there, but if our works were to go to the Museum of Modern Art, then we have to deal with international politics. Believe it or not, the Museum of Modern Art, the tag for Pablo Picasso is French, born in Spain. The tag for Marcel Duchamp is American, born in France. For people like Ana Mendieta and Felix Gonzalez Torres, they are American, born in Cuba. So I think that this whole question of where we were born, how we came to do what we do, in many ways, I don't think any of us ever processed through the filter of being one thing or another, being Cuban American, or being something else, whatever it was that we wanted to be. I'm reminded, incidentally, of Julio Blanc's own international projection. He was somebody that, in many ways, saw himself continuing the work of people like Alfred Barr, of the Museum of Modern Art, people like José Gómez Sicre, who eventually went to direct the Museum of the OAS in Washington. I think, in many ways, our generation did not have the pressure to be self-defined in any one way. And because we could be whatever we wanted to be, then we became many things. And I think that that is something that is very evident in the exhibition today.
The original 1903 exhibition was a really coming out exhibition for a whole generation of artists. And there were 9 of them included, but I think about 15 could have been included, of people who came from Cuba, who were raised in Miami, who came in Miami, who started exhibiting in the late 1970s. And here I have to make a little aside, because and I can mention a name that has been mentioned here tonight, and that is Margarita Cano. Because Margarita Cano was one of the first of the older generation of Cubans who saw the potential with these young artists and began to organize exhibitions at the public library. She was the art director of the public library, and began to bring them together. And then when the Cuban Museum of Art and Culture had its own place, she pushed that board to have this exhibition, and it happened. And one of them has been mentioned here today is Julio Blanc. And she was, some things sometimes they come together in ways that you cannot really plan. But she tapped on Julio Blanc to write the catalog and curate the exhibition. And it was just the best thing that could have happened, because here's a young, same generation of the artist, real smart, intelligent, well-educated individual who was interested in trying to figure out this generation of Cuban Americans and try to put them in some sort of context that was a large context, in the context of Cuban art, in the context of Miami, in the context of national North American art, in the context of European art. And that was magnificent, because as it has been said here, these artists are Cuban American, as Junior said, and more, much more, I would say. But having said that, I think that this idea of a coming out exhibition happened on at least three contexts. One of them was the context of the Cuban community itself. Because the Cuban community at the time, Cuban community up to the mid-70s, late-70s, they thought they were going back to Cuba any day. So there was no interest in a Cuban culture in Miami. It was such a thing. There's nothing to be interested in. Everything was sort of looking back to Cuba. And when they thought of art, they thought of an art that was produced in Cuba prior to 1959, or Cuban artists that were formed in Cuba and that now had went into exile and were producing art in exile. But the idea that there was a new generation of people that were young, that had been formed in Miami, and that actually writers and musicians and young artists born in Cuba were actually creating a culture in Miami, art in Miami, and literature and music, that was revolutionary at the time for them to acknowledge that. That was not something that was a given, as it is given today. And so this exhibition kind of opened up and said, hey, yeah, there's a culture here in Miami. We not only have succeeded politically, economically, but also culture. We have a culture of our own that is a Miami culture, Cuban American, if you want to call it that. I also think that the other context was the context of Miami itself. Miami, the art scene in Miami, as far as I can tell, began to form in the 1980s. Yes, there was art in Miami prior to the 1980s, I understand that. But the Center for the Fine Arts, the first museum, that now is the Paris Art Museum, the art in public places, the galleries in Bull Harbor that began to exhibit contemporary art, the galleries in Coral Gables that began to exhibit Latin American art, the Miami-Dade Community College galleries, the McCarty Gallery, the Miami-Dade Public Library, and then the Miami Herald was in the Miami Herald writing about what was going on. There were Miami News people writing about. That all began to happen in the 80s. And this group of people were part of that. All of a sudden, it was announced to the powers that be in Miami, there was a generation of Cuban Americans that were here. They're here to stay. They're producing very solid art, and we need to look at them. You know, and they made a contribution at the time. So that also was eye-opening to the community at large, not only the Cuban community, but the community at large. And beyond that, in terms of the nation, the 1980s, as you probably know, was a decade of multiculturalism and identity politics. And this exhibition that traveled was seen by people outside of Miami. And it had an impact, this and others, because this exhibition had an impact on a man named Mark Suber, that did an exhibition called Cuba, USA, the First Generation, that was Cuban Americans of the generation, but nationwide. And an exhibition that traveled all over the United States. And so when the concept of Latino art began to be developed in the United States, and we began to think of Latino art, there were not only the Chicanos over there in Texas and west of Texas, and the Negro Ricans in the Northeast, all of a sudden, there were the Cuban Americans in Miami, and they had to be dealt with, and they had to be included. And a number of traveling exhibitions then began to include the Cuban Americans from Miami. And even though this generation is very uneasy about terms of Cuban American, and even more the term Latino is like throwing a bomb, really. Nevertheless, it is those labels that have taken them to the national level. And I'm just going to finish with the three things here. The American Museum, the American Art Museum of the Smithsonian, okay, has a very large collection of so-called Latino art, and these artists are very well represented. A major exhibition was just in Miami, from that collection in which a number of artists here are represented there. So that's important. They have come to Miami. The curator came to Miami to see what was happening in Miami, as opposed to going to other places in the United States as well. Center for Latino Studies at UCLA began this major project called ABER, which is a monograph of artists that are in their mid and above mid career. They came to Miami too and chose artists from here to have monographs made. And one last thing, the Museum of Fine Arts in Houston has put together the biggest primary documents of Latin American and Latino art in the United States. Biggest ever. It's an amazing, amazing database. These artists are also represented there. So that exhibition really was the beginning of the breaking into, so the opening the doors and breaking the ice, okay? To have Cuban Americans represented at the table of American art. I think that's what I have to say.
Shared many teachers, and I recall a lot of people at the very
So in many ways, we were welcomed by these teachers, not as Cuban types, but as artists in the making, as curious individuals who were eager to project ourselves and have something to say.
Next question.
Just a minute. One of the most influential professors that I had is sitting over there. And he, I can remember talking to you about conceptual art and what it was, and it was always for me.
It's Fernando.
So Fernando also was very
Fernando.
Important. So just wanted to mention that.
If you have someone else, okay.
Yes, this is for Maria Brito. I was very impressed with one of the paintings in the gallery of the haircut. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about that painting, why you chose the colors and the hands holding the scissors.
Who was, I'm trying to think, forgive me, the mythological figure who's there, Samson. All right, it all goes back to different moments in my life. You know, I tried to sort of feed on the occurrences, what's happening in the moment, and sort of capitalize on that, always trying to make the work accessible and not totally autobiographical, you know, so hopefully the work is wide enough in concept that it may be interpreted in different ways by different people, but in essence, it's a self-portrait of myself holding up in a very forceful way, almost daring way, this cloth that's protecting me, and at the same time, my hair is being cut. Pretty much like Samson losing his strength when Delilah contributed to that.
She did.
Can I add something to that? Yeah, I'd like to also add to this that we were, we were training in painting and drawing and sculpture, but we also read. We were very conversant in poetry and in literature. And in the iconography, not only in mythology, but classical European painting. So our frame of reference and our working context was not that of like a Cuban costumbrista territory, but rather we saw the world of art as our source and as our area where we would eventually be contributing to.
Following up on that, César, and any of you who would care to speak to this, how did the evolution of exhibition opportunities and the coverage in first regional media and then beyond that affect your sense of who you were, and how did that translate into your own, you know, practically speaking, into the way that you created your art? Did some changes evolve out of what you were reading and the conversations that ensued from that? Can I answer that?
Yeah, before you answer it though, I would just like to say, if you're asking whether written criticism affects them, I think not. As the oldest critic in the room, I don't think so. But the only thing I just wanted to say was in the original show, which traveled to Philadelphia and Washington, D.C., and eventually to Panama in a different iteration, they all were covered by the local press, and it was all good. It was all good press. I don't think they got the nuances, but it was all very good press. So, yeah.
I just wanted to answer in general. You're talking about press that happened even before the Miami generation. And one of the most important reviews for me for my career was Helen Coleman's 1981 review of my show, The Pupil Progress. Pupil Progress, that was the name of the show. And the title of the review was The Pupil Progresses. And,
yeah, but that, I find your right headline, too. And it is right headlines.
But you did mention.
But I did. I was overwhelmed.
Oh.
And I remember that. In fact, all of you overwhelmed me, always.
She wrote, I remember. I was 20 when that review came out, and she wrote that youth is not wasted on the young, some of them create art.
a big influence. I think also at the time that we were starting to work, Miami had a number of critical voices. Helen's, of course, in the Herald, but also there were other people who wrote for the Miami News, the afternoon newspaper. I remember Lillian Dobbs and Leslie Allander, Paula Harper, a number of So everything that was happening in the media was part of our daily conversation. Because I don't think any of us really ever worked in order to impress a critic, if I may say so. But we were doing. Yes, yeah. But we were doing our work, and because it was so covered and there was so much genuine interest in what we were doing, that also energized our own conversations and our own empowerment as artists.
Yes, and I also want to say that these international artists came from families where they were really nurtured to be artists. And that was something new in the American thought processes, because for most Americans, if you want to be an artist, that's fine, as long as you're also a podiatrist. So, the American ethic was not really, it was maybe only 10 presidents ago who said there is no such thing as America. Was a Hoover or Coolidge, one of those said. It was in my lifetime that I remember. So, the fact is that the families not only encouraged their children to be artists, but came out for all the shows.
And I also think that in the case of some of us here at the table, we came alone as children. So we took autonomy of our own lives when we were very young. I mean, I got to Madrid alone, and then later I went to New York and was there alone. So at a young age, I had my own student. So this autonomy, I think that the parents picked up eventually when they came to the US and reunited with us. You are here because we wanted you to be free. So you do what you want. So I think that experience was one that I did. And I'm sure that if any of us were sent along.
Please, there's something I don't want to forget to say. And that is that Jorge Santis has put together this museum, what is really probably the most extensive and comprehensive collection of contemporary art of Cuban and Cuban Americans. In a very balanced way, he has now completely been blinded by recent arrivals and the fame and so on, but he has really sold out to also collect the Cuban Americans. And I see the parts here. I do hope, that this museum realizes what a valuable, incredible collection they have, really the best of contemporary Cuban art, and that it doesn't end with this exhibition. That's what I wanted to say.
Institutions who supported our work. The CITAS Foundation, which was the legacy think that's pretty much funded nearly all of us. At important points in our careers, where $3,000 was enough to really buy a lot of time and materials and equipment that we would otherwise not have. Same thing can be said for the National Endowment for the Arts, for the State of Florida Division of Cultural Affairs, eventually the South Florida Cultural Consortium. So we existed as individuals in our communities, but we also benefited from this great system of support that nurtured and in many ways encouraged artists to be what we became.
I think we're done. Thank you all for coming. I'd like to thank our moderators, Brito and Juan Martinez, who kept it moving and on time. And it was a truly historic discussion, which we have videotaped so we can watch in the future as well as everybody else who wasn't here tonight. I'd also like to thank the collectors who so kindly and generously loaned these treasures to the exhibition. We couldn't have done it without you. So thank you, and let's now go to the show.